It's a great pleasure and a great honor to have been invited to participate in this annual seminar, the One Asia Community in Cross-Cultural Dialogue with Europe. I'm going to try to provide you with a general overview of the combination between the new and the old in India, because I think it is important, especially for those of us who come from Western countries, from Europe and from the United States, to be aware that there are other modernities other than what we are living in our own countries, because especially in Asia, there are countries that have very, very long traditions, like China, Japan, India, and the way they are accessing modernity is quite different from the way that we are coming to modernity in Western Europe or in the United States. India is a very important regional actor in this part of the world, and all the analysts and all the people that study international relationships, economy and so on, foresee that the role that India is going to play along over the 21st century is going to be more and more important. I have here the figures provided by the last published OECD economic survey, and you can see that it's a very recent report. It has been published in February this year, so it's very updated. They are giving statistics going back to 2015, more or less, for some figures they have information that it's a bit older, but the estimated population is almost 1.3 billion people. But many analysts say that this is an underestimation, because it is difficult to really know how many people are living in India, because for certain areas it is very difficult, it is almost impossible to have accurate figures. So some analysts say that you were right, because some analysts say that there are more than 1.4 or almost 1.5 billion people living in India nowadays. India is indeed a big country, but it is not so big in comparative terms. It's less than 9 times bigger than Spain. So that means that if we project 9 times bigger than Spain, then if they had a population similar to Spain in terms of density and so on, we would expect 450 million people, and we are speaking of more than 1 million people there. Population density per square kilometer, you can see it here, is more than 400 people per square kilometer. So that means that it is not only a country with many people living in the country, it means that it is densely populated. The population under 15 is almost one third of the population in India. That means that there are a lot of young people living in India. It is an advantage in a sense, because young people are more energetic. They have a life to live. They are going to fight for their lives. They are going to try to have a good future and so on. But on the other hand, Just think of the problems that the government has to face, because you have to provide access to education for everyone, for instance. Okay, I wanted to draw your attention to some of the figures here too, and it is the contribution of the various economic sectors to the GDP, to the global economy of the country. For instance, if you I know that you cannot read it, but I'm reading it aloud for you. The primary sector contributes less than 20% of the income of the country, while the secondary sector, industry and so on, provides almost one third, 29.7%. While services contribute more than half of the income of the country. Why are services so important in India, and what kind of services is India good for? Have you heard about anything that Indian people do especially well, and why should companies be interested in placing offices and working in India instead of going elsewhere? Don't look at her, just speak for your own.
Yeah.
Computer has been hearing. Sorry? Computer, yeah, that's really important. Computer and engineering. In fact, that's been one of the bets of the Indian government. They have created ITs, Institutes of Technology, in many important places in India or over the country. So they are very good at computer science, engineering, and so on. And it is relatively easy to find well-prepared people in India in these areas. While again, they have very good universities, obviously, because it is a very good country, but they have put much more effort in these areas than, for instance, in humanities or in social sciences and so on. I'm not saying that they don't have good professors of humanities and social sciences or whatever, but I'm saying that they have made a special effort in ITs. More than 20% of the people living in India are below the line of poverty. And that's a challenge for the Indian government and for regional governments in India too, because in a country like India, you don't only have to encourage economic growth, but you have to encourage also at the same time a certain redistribution, because nowadays, there are so many people in India living below the line of poverty. And that again, poses special problems, because they don't have access to education, they don't have access to health services, and so on. But there is something I would like to underline as well, in order not to be so negative, because it wouldn't be fair. If you think about many African countries, if you look at the figures they had, I don't know, like 20 years ago, 15 years ago, or whatever, and you look at the figures they have now, for instance, concerning access to health, education, and so on, the variation would be very, very small. They haven't been improving over these years. In contrast, if you look at the figures in India, when you compare the historical series, if you compare the statistics of 20 years ago to the statistics that we have nowadays, you can see that they are improving. Sometimes there is this improvement is slow, and all of us would love to see that they are making better and faster, but the interesting thing is that it's not a desperate case, if I can put it that way. Okay, we are going now to start discussing a bit culture, but before going into certain aspects of Indian culture, I would like to make you think about the idea of culture, and I think that's interesting after having followed a seminar like this one. I have taken this definition from a book by Francis Fukuyama. Obviously, I'm not saying that this is the best definition from a sociological or anthropological or political point of view, but I think it's a challenging definition. I don't know if the name rings a bell. Have you ever heard about Francis Fukuyama? No? Okay, he wrote a very influential book at the end of the 20th century, The End of History, and he was one of the most important thinkers of the American establishment, especially the Republican Party. And besides that book, The End of History, that was really, really important in international relationships and so on, he also wrote this book, on Trust, the Social Virtues and the Creation of Prosperity, in which he argued that societies in which people can trust each other do it better in economic terms. Because if you can trust the people you are living with, then the economy is going to grow easier, because you are not worried about, I don't know, if I lend money, are they going to give it back to me or not, and things like that. So that it's very important. I'm not saying that I agree with him 100%, but it is an interesting analysis that tries to bring together ethics and behavior with the economy, and that's important. But what I wanted to discuss with you now is his idea of culture. You can see that he defines culture as inherited ethical habit. Would you agree that a culture is a habit? Yes, no, why? When you think about culture, do you think it as do you think it as a habit?
Yes.
Okay.
Traditions.
Traditions. All of you agree?
Me, I don't. Okay. But like, I'm not sure because for me, traditions are a habit, but culture, I think, is maybe something different than tradition. Because tradition is following some values.
Okay.
That's a habit.
That's a habit. Yeah.
But culture.
Okay.
I
think that he put this definition because he was thinking of this idea of tradition, obviously, and the idea of tradition is also here, inherited. Culture is inherited. But that doesn't mean that it cannot change. I mean, it's something that we inherit, but it doesn't mean that it cannot change. We can make change our own culture, and in fact, most of you have been involved in social studies and humanities, so you know that over history there have been cultural changes, important cultural changes. But on the other hand, we are building on the tradition. We are born into a culture, and sometimes we are not even aware what some of our attitudes, some of our beliefs, our behaviors, and so on, depend on the culture we have been born in. Because a culture, unless we make a conscious effort of reflection, of thinking about our own culture, most people tend to assume that what they do is natural. And instead, it is not natural, it is something that belongs to our culture. So culture is partly tradition, something that we have inherited. And why do you think that he has emphasized this ethical aspect? What has ethics to do with culture?
Because maybe culture is not, I would say, unethical, but I mean that culture is not harmful, I think. That would be maybe tradition. There are some traditions that are harmful, but culture maybe not.
Okay.
Culture is some habits, which could change, like. Right now I can't think maybe what.
Okay.
I think more about it.
Yes, please.
I think it's because each culture thinks that what they do is good.
Okay. Yeah, the way we see our own actions and what other people do depends on our culture, because the way we think of ourselves and the way we think about the others depend on our culture. And you're right when saying that what in a culture can be considered right, in another culture can be considered wrong. And this is a very interesting debate in humanities and in social sciences, because if we want to overcome this relativism, we have to be aware of, I mean, even if we want to go beyond this relativism, we have to be aware of these cultural differences. For what for a culture is good, for another culture can be wrong. So our way of not only of behaving, but also of judging the world and judging the people around us depends on our own culture. So that's very important. Well, he goes on and says that culture is a compound of images. Okay, it's representations. Representations are crucial for our culture. Habits, what we are used to doing. Social opinions. And here comes a very interesting word, because you can see that he defines culture, this compound of images, habits, and social opinions, and he says that they are irrational. And I suppose that this is the first time that you hear or you read this word irrational, because sometimes you can read that something is rational, or you can read that something is irrational. But he has avoided saying either rational or irrational. Why do you think that he has chosen to define culture as irrational? In Spanish, it would be the same. It would be no sería ni racional ni irracional, sino irracional. Why do you think that he is trying to define culture as irrational? Yes, please.
Because when you think of culture, you don't try to make it
symbolological. You say my culture, that's what people have been doing for now what how long in my country or in my culture. Mm-hmm. So it's not that much about if it's logical or illogical or how people, they don't try to explain it like this has to be like this because it's the most rational thing.
Okay, I think that we could agree on that. I mean that cultures are not rational because there is no design behind them in the sense that no one has stopped to think, okay, we have to do it this way, we have to do it the other way, this is logical from this point of view or whatever. It's something we do and we don't pay attention to logical reasoning or whatever, it belongs to the culture and so on. But then my question would be, why not simply saying cultures are irrational?
Because they are not irrational either, because they don't put rationality in the context. They're not like saying, no, I'm getting away from all the logic and all. No, it's like I don't take even ration into account to describe culture.
Okay, but if you don't take into account logic and so on, I'm insisting. Then why you wouldn't say, okay, this culture is irrational, but we don't feel that we should say that cultures are irrational.
Yes.
I would like to hear more comments about this. Yes, please.
I think it's because there is no universal
Okay, I see your point, but don't you think that what you're saying, it's okay? Let's assume that cultures are indeed irrational, but we cannot say that. But I think that Fukuyama is trying to go a bit farther. Yes, please.
Maybe because, as you say, each country has its own culture, but sometimes there's no neutral situation from where you can judge and say this is irrational or not, because each one is something different and each different you can think that is rational for another culture could be rational.
Okay.
So it's not a center from which you can judge all the rest of cultures. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I think that that's very interesting. And let's try to put it as a question. Okay, yes.
Well, I think that it's not rational, not irrational.
Okay.
But different from irrational.
Okay.
Maybe.
Okay.
Let's
try to put it in this way. When we look at cultures from outside, they seem to be irrational because there is no logic to them. If you think of what the first time you are, I don't know, in the middle of a festival or a celebration or a ritual or whatever, if you are looking at if you're looking at it as an outsider, then you don't find the logic. Because you don't know the rules of the culture. So from one perspective, when you are looking at them as a neutral observer, as an outsider, they don't have a logic. But if you are inside the culture, they have a logic of their own. So that's why you cannot say that cultures are irrational. Because once you are inside the culture, you start to find the meaning of the things that people are doing and the rights they are performing and so on. So it is this combination of irrationality when looked from outside, and rationality, logic, when you are inside the culture, that it is very interesting. I have taken the information from a very useful website, ethnologue.com, and it's a website that provides very interesting information about languages in the world. The languages spoken in a country, you can perform searches by country, by language, and you will find the information about the languages. Again, I'm sure that you cannot read what they say here, but according to the ethnologue, the number of individual languages listed for India is 452. Of those, 438 are living languages and 14 have no known speaker. So more than 400 languages. How do you deal with such a huge linguistic diversity? There are these two national languages, Hindi and English, and then 22 official scheduled languages. And those are languages that are official in one particular region or two regions where they are spoken. For instance, Punjabi or Santali or Tamil or Telugu. but don't think that these are small languages, because for instance, more than 50 million people speak Tamil or Telugu. Those are the regional languages spoken in the south, but when we are saying that they are regional languages, please don't think that they are spoken just by 1 million people or whatever. In India, everything is big numbers, and speakers of Tamil and Telugu are more than 50 million people. So those are really important languages, but they are only official in their own territory. 200,000 people say that English is their mother tongue. Only 200,000 people in India say, when they are asked for the census, that English is their mother tongue. Here I wanted to show you, to tell you something about writing in India, because it is not only that they have such a huge diversity of languages, there are also different scripts. For instance, you have here a trilingual sign. I took this picture at the National Museum at Kolkata. It is written in Bangla here, the language spoken in Bengala, and also in Bangladesh. And this is Hindi here, and then you have English here. By the way, Indian scripts are not so complicated as Chinese or Japanese or whatever, because they are phonetic. So if you want to be able to read Nagari or any other script, you can learn it relatively fast, because if you have to learn like 40, 50 signs, it's not that complicated. I won't explain things about the scripts, but I just wanted to show you, to give you a taste of the different scripts that they use in India. This is very nice, because it seems that we have twice the same thing, but it's not the case. It's simply that they use the same script, Devanagari, for Hindi and for Maharashtri. So it is two different languages, but they use the same script. That's why it seems that we have twice the same thing. And the languages are both Indo-Aryan languages, so some words are even the same, because if you have a look at the word here, it is the same in both languages. Hindus are about 80% of the population, then come Muslims, about 13% of the population, and then 2% of Christians, about 2% of Sikhs, and less than 1% of Buddhists. Many people think that there are so many Buddhists in India because Buddhism originated in India. And in fact, it was the official religion promoted by the Indian rulers, especially in northern India, until about the 2nd, 3rd century AD. What the Indian constitution says is that you cannot be discriminated due to your own caste. But it's a constitution cannot say that castes are banned, because a constitution cannot deal with religious things from this point of view. If you are a Hindu and if you believe in traditional in the traditional Hindu ideas, then you have to believe in caste. So that's something interesting, this coexistence of the idea of caste with modernity, and it's something that many Indian families are struggling with. Some families don't pay so much attention to caste nowadays, but others do, and I suppose that some of you have watched films of dealing with teenagers that have been living in, I don't know, in the United Kingdom or in Canada or in the United States, and when they have to get married, their parents look for a girl or a boy to marry them, because they want to marry them inside the same caste. That's frequently the case. So, for instance, in Indian newspapers, you can find sections of matrimonials, because some people want to find a bride or a groom for their children, and they want to then to belong to the same caste. Well, thank you very much for your attention.